If you are like me and end up prototyping on a breadboard where your components end up being loose and making it very difficult to troubleshoot, take your projects or your prototyping to the next level by going to PCBWay and getting a proper PCB manufactured for your prototyping or your next project. Simply head over to the PCBWay website and click on Instant Quote, and there you can provide the specifications and the requirements for your project and simply place your order. Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this review where we're going to take a look at the InfiniRay C200 thermal camera. Now, I warn you up front, there's going to be a fair bit in this video. I hadn't realized what a beautiful gem this camera is, and it deserves the time to look at it properly, understand its performance, and a little bit of its background, because that'll probably give you an appreciation for this device. So let me just jump in with a fairly bold statement before we get down to the facts and figures, because many folks might get lost in many of the facts and figures I'm going to talk about, particularly if you haven't dealt with those specifications on thermal cameras. But I've had a fair number of certainly middle of the range thermal cameras in my hands before, from the likes of Fluke, FLIR or FLIR, who have however you want to pronounce it, and a whole host of others. I have a whole lot of benchmarks or testing that I've put them through. I've got those up on my website, and I can certainly say that this camera, particularly for the price point and even disregarding the price point, is one of the best performers I've had in my hands to date. And that is saying something, because this costs a third or a quarter of the price of some of those cameras. So let's just put this in perspective. So first of all, InfiniRay, I had not heard the name before. At the beginning of this year, they approached me and said, we are busy developing a camera, a kind of medium price camera. We see the work that you've done before. Would you be willing to have a look at our product? Now, I say, I get a lot of these requests, and potentially the way they're worded and what have you, I tend to toss them out. I'm glad I paid this company some attention. So first off, this company, their key business is actually producing microbolometers. So that is the thermal sensor inside thermal cameras, right? And they have produced some really high performance microbolometers. So a year ago, and I'll put it up here on the screen, they produced apparently the world's first 10 micrometer. So 10 micrometers, that's the size of the pixel pitch of the sensor. So that means you've got really small pixels to do high resolution measurement. They produced the world's first 10 micrometer uncooled microbolometer. It's a HD, I think it's 1280 by, it's an HD resolution basically. So they certainly know what they're doing in terms of producing microbolometers, and they have a host of products which they build using their microbolometers. Now this has a 12 micrometer pixel pitch sensor inside this camera. It also has a very good NetD or sensitivity rating of less than 50 millikelvin. That is several times better than other cameras I've reviewed. We're going to go to the bench. I'm going to show you around this device, and then we'll put it through some testing. I'm also going to show you the software, because the software is one of the key strengths of this thermal camera. The price point, so let me just highlight, right now you cannot easily buy this in the US. They are selling it on Alibaba. They do intend selling it on Amazon in the kind of 400 to 500 price range. Now, the reason I mention this is that in the last 5 years since I did my big review, Fluke and FLIR tended to dominate this area. They started bringing out more lower performance, reasonably priced thermal cameras, and since then there have been a whole lot of companies, particularly Chinese companies, which have jumped in, and they'll just go grab a cheap microbolometer off the shelf from whoever's producing them, slap them in something, and sell it at these really low prices, particularly in the anywhere from $200 to $500 price point. So in this price point for the resolution of this camera, which is 256 by 192, you're going to find a lot of other cameras, but InfiniRay certainly seem to
to put it together because they are building the heart. They build their own high-performance microbolometers, and that's potentially what makes this very special. But anyway, let's take it to the bench.
Right then, so before we get started, let me just talk about the specifications. I'll probably pop up something on the screen here so you can actually see their documentation. I also want to highlight though, and this is why I did a big review and comparison of multiple cameras about 5 years ago, is because often the specifications which you get from each of the manufacturers, you cannot easily do comparisons because of the way they state them. And often I found the cameras didn't live up to those specifications. So I'll quote them, right? But ultimately we want to test and see how well it does perform. So this, as I noted, has got a sensor that is 256 by 192. The visual camera in here is, they quote on the box that it's 640 by 480, but I think that's probably a misprint on the box. As I said, this is a very new product. In the blurb, in their specifications, they quote 320 by 240, which I think is more realistic. The temperature rating of this, minus 20 degrees Celsius to 550 degrees Celsius. And that goes way beyond any other camera I've tested. I cannot actually test it up to the full limit, but I'm going to show you a demonstration to show how you switch to a mode where you can get those higher temperature measurement ranges with this camera. It is IP54 rated, so that is kind of the top end of a normal handheld thermal camera. As I noted, the net D or sensitivity specification for this is less than 50 millikelvin, and that is at least two or three times better than any other camera that I've tested previously. And again, when we start looking at the pictures that it takes, those are the ultimate proof in terms of its sensitivity. The field of view, one of the best that I've had in my hands, 56 by 42.2 degrees. Now the field of view, I say the best, it depends on your application. If you have a sensor of a certain resolution and you stick a really big lens on there which gives it a wide field of view, that will potentially reduce the amount of resolution or your sensitivity that you're going to get, because you're trying to view a far bigger picture for the resolution of the sensor. And so sometimes it might be better to have a narrower field of view for a particular sensor. And it depends on your application. If you're doing close-up work, you probably want a narrow field of view, because then you're gaining the benefit of less field of view for your sensor size. If you're doing home inspections, you probably want a wider field of view, but then you do want a relatively good sensor to go along with that, or else you're going to lose the kind of resolution because you're trying to look at a lot more. The instantaneous field of view, which is basically a measurement of the level of detail that you can see at a certain distance, and what goes into that is also then how accurately you can measure a small level of detail in the distance, and there also comes in your distance to spot ratio. That is noted as 3.8 milliradians, and that is probably the third best spec that I've had in terms of that specification. But this camera, in terms of the distance to spot ratio, although they don't quote it, I've tested it and seen that it achieves somewhere around 90:1. So that means, let's say for over here, you can see I've got this little test, 10 millimeter or 1 centimeter hole. I can be 90 centimeters away and get a reading very close to the actual reading within that hole when I'm close up versus 90 centimeters. And that is far better than any other camera that I've had in my hands. I've had cameras quoting they can do 100:1 or 120:1, and they've never achieved that. They've gone to like 30:1, maybe 50:1. I think the best camera I've seen is around in the 60s. This seems to get around 90:1. The speed of the shutter, I reckon, is somewhere between 6 to 9 hertz. They do other cameras which do far faster camera shutter speeds. In this case, because this doesn't do video inside the camera, you can with the software. I'm going to talk about that when we get to the software. There's a lot under development with this camera and the software at the moment. But for the still pictures that it takes, and again, I'm going to demonstrate this. If you take a picture of something that's moving, it manages to do a very good capture, even at the whether it's 6 or 9 hertz that it's operating at. I say they don't actually quote that. They do other they do other high performance cameras that do 50, 60 hertz and above, but this one is not noted as being a high performance camera. Right, so I'm going to do something unusual, which I don't normally do, is show you the packaging, because I have some criticism about it, and it's going to seem like crazy criticism. So let me just show you that. And again, I'm not into unboxings or the packaging that products come in, but it does say something when you get something in a really good package. And my criticism of this packaging is that I think they've gone over the top. I think they should actually provide this camera in far cheaper, less fancy packaging to perhaps bring the price point down even further. The box is kind of one of those, like if you're getting an iPhone, it's got this really nice high quality, almost rubberized like feel to it. When you open it up, it's a really nice box. It does come with a 16 gig SD card for storing images. It's got this high density foam inside here, and then the camera is inside here. I received this box inside a nice big outer box with big proper padding. It was like an enclosed cell. I could have dropped that box off a 10-story building and this camera would easily have survived it. This camera does have a 2-meter drop rating. I'm going to show you that on the bench, how they've built the protection and the casing around it. Right, so as we take a physical look at the camera, I can tell you it feels really nice in the hand. It has a nice trigger. I'm going to talk about this trigger operation when we come to taking pictures. There's a little bit of improvement, which I think can certainly be done in the software, the way the picture is taken. But it has this rubber coating around the outside. It comes with a USB-C type connector in the top here. Your SD card, which is supplied, slots in over there. The USB, as I recall, charges this camera in 4 hours. I'll put up these stats if I'm getting it wrong, but it's 4 hours, and they claim 11 hours use on the camera. I've not checked the 11 hour usage figure. I just haven't had the time. But a nice robust cover. If you know a previous camera that I had, the cover which covered the USB and the SD card broke off literally while I was testing. This is held on with a nice tag. It feels nice and robust. When you slip it down, you can tell it seals nicely, so I can understand that it'll operate within its IP54 rating. It feels good in the hand. It's not too heavy. And the way they've designed this rubber around it, if I roll this camera right around, none of the critical parts actually will hit the surface. The only part of this plastic is this small area over here will actually touch a working surface. So like the screen and these buttons, if it's like that, none of those actually touch down because they've got this raised rubber protection around it. So if it fell like that, it's not going to hit the screen or any of the buttons. Likewise in the front, the lenses are all protected in the front as well. So I can truly believe that it would be able to withstand a 2-meter fall and come out okay. I say, unless if it's slapped right down on the side here, you might get some scuffing. I don't know whether the plastic would crack, but it would literally have to be right on this side. But anywhere else is protected by rubber. On the front of the camera, we've got the thermal lens over here in the middle. We've got the visual camera lens at the bottom, and then we've got two LED lights. So those, again, very helpful. You can switch those on. You've got a single button if you're in a dark spot and you want more light for the visual camera, because it'll automatically take the thermal image and a visual image. You don't have to worry about that each time you pull the trigger. And then when you get to the software, you can flick between the two or various blended modes. And again, the software and the analysis that you can do with software which isn't complicated, very intuitive to use, I think is outstanding. It makes for, and this is something I want to highlight, most of us are not thermal camera professionals. There are courses on how to use a thermal camera properly. And for most of us, myself included, we will generally go, point it at something, pull the trigger, and then walk away and hope we've got a good picture. And having good software so that you can alter settings and see things after the fact makes up for perhaps the more sloppy use of folks like me and potentially you who might not know how to use a thermal camera properly. And again, I'll demonstrate that before I was even properly evaluating this. When I was testing my solar panels outside, I just took some quick snaps so that I had them. And then after the fact, once I got the software, I was able to take a closer look and analyze those pictures and see things which I certainly didn't think I was capturing at the time when I took the picture. Right, so when we power this up, it boots up with the InfiniRay logo. And I'll just show you how long it does take to boot. It takes a little bit of time to boot up. So here we go. Bang. And there we go, it's booted up already. And now I'll bring you in a little closer. Right, so sorry, there might be some reflections as I turn this around. I'll try and avoid that if possible. On the display, you'll have your readings, which of course you can alter. You've got your spot, you can change it to with no spot. You can have a hot and a cold spot. You've got your temperature reading, which again, you can change between Fahrenheit, Kelvin, or Celsius. You've got your time and date stamps, your battery status. You have your palette on the side here. So your palette is the color choice. You can have like a black and white, where white is hot or white is cold. You can change various color palettes, and it also gives you the temperature range for the palette. So the one thing I'll highlight that they might perhaps should consider changing the software is you cannot lock this palette. When you put something in front of the camera, that palette is automatically going to change the temperature range for the range of the palette, and that can have a marked effect on the performance, the noise, and what you see in an image. And sometimes being able to lock that palette at a certain range can be really helpful. However, in the software, after the fact, when you're analyzing a picture, you can go and change that manually yourself. So although you can't do it in the camera, it's not the end of the world, you can actually go and change that in the software. You get your emissivity rating down over here, which again, if you don't have it set up correctly on the camera, you can go and alter that when you do the analysis after the fact, which is really handy. You've got your switches, your power switch, a back button. This goes into a menu system, which I'll show you now. You can go and look at previous pictures which you've got stored in the camera. I've got several in here. So I can go and click on one, bring it up, and then go and scroll through various pictures. So here is a spoiler picture, which we'll have a look at when we get to the software. But I took a picture up of the ceiling area above the bunk bed, right above my bench over here. And what can you see? And this just shows you the sensitivity. And when we get into the actual software, when you look at the temperature differential between these blue spots, which is showing the framing behind the sheetrock, you can see the framing very clearly, and you can see the trusses in my roof. And a camera needs to have really good sensitivity and be able to see those details at a distance to be able to bring this out in a picture. And I say that's where this one does really, really well. Okay, so that's viewing pictures. We then do have this button over here to switch on the LED. So if I push that and hold it, the LEDs come on to light up what you're looking at. Let me just highlight taking a picture. You've got a mode where it says auto save, so as opposed to having to acknowledge, you can have it so when you pull the trigger, it'll automatically save the image, which I really like. I like that it gives you that choice. So you either decide whether you want to save that picture or not, or it'll auto save. My only criticism on this with the trigger works really nicely. You'll hear that click. There we go, it saved a picture. Now I'm going to do that again.
it saved it. So now it's not doing it. I found sometimes that when I did this, it wouldn't take a picture. If I did just a slow, steady click, it sometimes wouldn't take the picture. I had to do, it almost wants like a very quick trigger to actually take the picture. And the danger is when you do that, you actually might end up moving the camera and causing basically a little bit of blur in the picture. So there it's working. I'm going to take one a bit slower. So isn't that odd? The one thing I was critical about, it's not doing on camera right now. But that was something I'm going to highlight and test more of that, because I'm going to give them feedback on potential changes they could make. Because as I said, when we get down to the application, I'll talk about some of the things I brought to their attention. They said, oh, we can change that in software and firmware. It's not a problem. They have other cameras which have the capabilities which I haven't brought down to this one. And they said we could specifically change the firmware if you think that would be a good feature to have. And again, I'll bring that out as we get into the review. So when you push the middle button over here, you can see you get into, I'll try and avoid the reflections, you get into the settings, you can get into measurement, you can change whether you want a center spot, a hot spot, a cold spot, or no spot at all. You get into the image mode, you can request a thermal image. Fusion, so over there you can see it's blending a thermal image with the actual visual image as well. You've got just the visual picture, and then you can also change the alignment. So the one challenge with these cameras, when you've got both a thermal camera and a visual camera, you can have parallax error. So depending on the distance that you're at, it might not be able to align the thermal image with the visual image. So you can go and change that to get that lined up. So that if you're taking a picture close up, and I think it's within roughly 25 centimeters and out, you can go and you can adjust that so that they will line up. Now again, the beauty of this is that even though you may set this setting over here, so when you actually take the picture, the picture that you would replay in the camera will be displayed by whatever you set here. Once you get into the software, you can change that. So just because you've decided to have, let's say, thermal fusion, or let's say picture in picture, or a digital picture, it doesn't mean you lose the other options. Those are available to you once you get to the analysis software, which is great. You've then got your palette. You can obviously go and change between your various palettes, your different color palettes. You've got your where you have your black is hot or your white is hot. Sometimes these kind of black and white modes can almost give you some better definition, because you're removing the color if you're purely trying to find a hot spot or a cold spot, and you're not looking for all the gradual colors in between. This can sometimes give you, you can spot temperature differentials sometimes easier in these modes than you can with the color modes. So I'll change it back to the iron, which tends to be the most common. You then can go into your settings, and then you've got a whole host of settings where you can go and change these parameters like emissivity, your ambient temperature, and your distance. And these, again, you can change in the software after the fact. So even if you mess things up here, you can actually do it after the fact. You can change your units as noted between Celsius, Fahrenheit, and Kelvin. You can change your high and low alert, so you can set the camera to alert you when if you hit a certain temperature threshold. So this is a really nice feature, because, and I forgot to mention, it's got a tripod mount, which is really handy. So if you go and mount it up and you've got it on your bench and you want an alert that something's reached a certain temperature, then you can do this. Now the one thing that it doesn't do in camera, which potentially the software does, now I say potentially, this is for the software application where it allows you to monitor something and take pictures if something reaches a certain temperature, is in the software for another camera. But they said they can
change the firmware to allow this camera to have that functionality. But I believe, like I have cheaper cameras with this functionality where I could have this on the bench, I have an application where I ask the camera to either take a picture of a circuit or a breaker box. If let's say one of the breakers reaches a certain temperature, or if I'm in a factory and I'm monitoring a motor at night, I could set this up on a tripod, leave it, come back in the morning, and then look at the pictures that it's taken. It'll only take the pictures where it's crossed a certain threshold, and I can then see at what time and what those temperature thresholds were on the motor in the factory when I wasn't there. And that, I believe, would be very handy if they brought that into the camera. You've got the auto save. Like I said, you can tell it to either save when you just trigger, or it'll actually prompt you. You've got the temperature scale here. Very interesting. I hadn't realized, they didn't actually mention this in the manual. And again, because this is such a new product, they're still developing the software and the manual. If you do want to do those high temperature measurements up above, I think it's above 170 odd degrees Celsius, then you switch it into the low gain mode. So you don't get the low temperature measurement. It has to obviously change the mode of the camera, but then you get this fantastic temperature range measuring that high. None of the other cameras that I've had have gone and measured that high. And that is done in this menu setting over here. You've got your date and time. You can set the language. You can set the brightness. You can set an auto power off. And then you've got system settings. Right then, so the first thing I'm going to show you is that I've got my little test device, which I test most of my cameras with. And that is, I've got two Peltier Elements sat there. I have three measurement probes, one so that we can look at the temperature sensitivity. These are connected in series, but the polarity of one is switched around. So the one will get cold and the one will get hot. And I do that so we can set up to see at what temperature we can see a line forming to get an idea of the temperature sensitivity that we can detect with the camera. Now, the one thing I want you to realize is just the resolution of the picture. You may see sometimes that as I'm moving my hand will freeze. It does have a shutter which does a uniformity calibration. Basically, most cameras have this. Some of them have and are shutterless, but this one has a shutter which will, there we go, it just froze there. Microbolometers have to do a uniformity check across all the pixels, and they do that by closing the shutter, having a black body, taking a picture, and then calibrating so they get uniformity across the sensor. So for one, just note the resolution. You're not seeing any visual picture. Many cameras need to actually blend in a visual picture with a thermal image to get this kind of representation. But the resolution that this camera is at, you get a really good picture just with a thermal image, even without the visual representation. So as I look here, I'm pointing right at the temperature probe measurement. And we have got 23.5 on the camera. And the calibrated thermometer over there is showing 24. The specifications for non-contact devices like these thermal cameras is normally plus or minus 2 degrees Celsius, so that we can see in terms of its accuracy at this temperature range, there's no problem at all. If I go and touch my finger, you'll see, if you look at the camera, if I just go and touch that very briefly, you'll see how my handprint has left a mark. Now, this is, lots of cameras can do this, but depending on their sensitivity will govern how well they can see a very quick temperature touch and still measure, like for instance, my handprint. So if I take my hand out of the picture, so I'm not messing up with the palette, the range that the palette is doing, you can still clearly see my handprint there a fair time after I've gone and removed my hand. Right, so now what I'm going to do, I'm going to start putting a very low current through these Peltier elements, and then I'm going to set up on the thermometer over here. I'm going to set it up so we can see the temperature differential, so the difference between one probe versus the other. Now, let me just bring you in a little closer so that you can see the resolution in this camera. So if I bring you in and you can have a look at how clearly you can see the lines on my hand. And again, if I go and put my hand down and remove it, you can see how easily it picks up that thermal image of where I placed my hand. And because it is that sensitive, it'll be able to see that image for a long time. It can still see that temperature differential of where I placed my hand. Right, so for this test, I need to be very careful. It's very easy to upset things. On the thermometer over here, we've got T1 minus T2. So at the moment, down to the first decimal, there's no temperature difference between the two probes which are sitting on the two Peltier elements, either side of the line. So although you can't see it in front of the camera, I've got a line drawn on the board underneath, but that line will become apparent. I'm going to make it obvious and then step it down to see when we struggle to see the difference between the two, and then we'll look at the temperature difference on the thermometer. What I'm going to do, I'm actually going to remove the target so we've got nothing blocking. So if I go into the settings and go into measurement, I can take away the spot so that we've just got the image. So I'm going to dial things up. So we should see, and you can see it already, is there is a different, you can suddenly see the square forming. There's the Peltier element on this side over here. I'm going to bring you closer into the image. You can see the Peltier element on this on the side here versus the other one. Now, because my fingers are in here, I'm messing up the palette and what you can see. But if I remove my hand, you can clearly see the temperature differential between the two. And at the moment, that is at 0.9 degrees. So if I bring the camera back and you have a look at the temperature reading over here, hopefully you can see it. It says 0.9 degrees. Now, I have cameras which could only detect that temperature differential above 1 degree. Some of the better cameras I've got go down to half or 0.4 of a degree, but we want to see what this can go down to. So what I've done on my power supply, I've turned the voltage right down. So basically, these are going to start to equalize, and the temperature difference between them should start to equalize, and there won't be much difference. We're down to 0.6 degrees at the moment. I'll just call out the readings, and then you can keep an eye on the image here, and then we'll see at what point where we cannot detect that difference on the camera. So we're at 0.6. I'm actually going to switch the power supply off because I know this camera is that sensitive. Unless I actually stop putting current, here we go, 0.5. We can still see a difference. I can still see a difference between the two. We're at 0.4. I can see a difference on the camera. 0.3. We're at 0.3. Just starting to disappear on my eye. I'm not sure what you can see on the camera. I can just see a difference at about 0.3, 0.2. I'll bring you back out so you can see, hopefully see the thermometer. We're down to 0.2. And at 0.2, it becomes a little difficult to discern, but that is really, really low, 0.2 of a degree. And you'll see that once we start, I show you some of the pictures I've taken where we look at the framing in the wall or the roof or what have you, it doesn't take much differential to be able to, for those to stand out, because this camera is so sensitive and it can do readings at a distance.